So what would it look like to really live out our lives with Pentecost as a central defining reality? What would it look like to order our lives as something, our lives as flowing from Pentecost? You know, back before Vatican II, the Sundays after Pentecost were just numbered as the second Sunday after Pentecost, the third Sunday after Pentecost, the fourth Sunday after Pentecost. And now the church, we use ordinary time, but it's still the same thing. Ordinary doesn't mean boring time. It means ordered, like the ordinal numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, ordinal numbers. It means the counted time flowing from Pentecost. So it's still the same thing. So, you know, but it would be a little weird if we said, well, today is the 103,532nd Sunday of after Pentecost, right? Just like it'd be like, what was it, 1,991 years after Pentecost? And so, but we want to dive into this a little bit using some of the words from the sequence, using the scriptures, of course, to say what are three components if we really lived out of the graces of Pentecost. First, we know that the Lord sent the Holy Spirit to be the soul's most welcomed guest. We heard that in the sequence today. The soul's most welcome guest. We know, hopefully, that the Lord doesn't want a distant relationship with us. That's how other false religions were. The gods were up there, we're down here, try not to make them mad so they don't shoot you with lightning bolts. And that is not Christianity. That's not good news. That's what every other religion on the planet had. The good news, at the center of the good news, is that the Lord so loves us that he wants to give his very self to dwell in us. The Lord wants to dwell in our souls. He doesn't want a distant relationship. He wants union. He wants to make us living tabernacles. He wants to make us living temples. And so this is why he ascends into heaven, so that he could send the Holy Spirit. As amazing as the incarnation is, as amazing as it is for Christ to live 33 years on earth, he didn't want to be limited in one physical location and say, okay, you got to come visit me and take a plane and wait in line, and, you know, because now there's lots of people that want to see me, so you're just going to get a few seconds. No, he wants to live in our soul 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, now and into eternity. And he sends the Holy Spirit to enliven, to be the soul of the church, to be the soul that that vivifies, that makes possible the sacraments that make us new. The sacrament of baptism, where we receive sanctifying grace, where we receive the indwelling of the Trinity, where the sacrament of confession, where we're forgiven and restored to that grace if we've lost it through one mortal sin. We know the sacrament of the Holy Eucharist, where Christ dwells with us in his precious body, blood, soul, and divinity, which we celebrate every day, but especially we'll celebrate in a special way in Corpus Christi. But he doesn't just live there in the tabernacle to just stay there, as amazing as that is. No, he wants to come to us, wants to give his very self. And so in John, we hear Jesus say, "But you shall know him," speaking of the Holy Spirit, "because he will dwell with you and be in you." We are made to be temples. And so this is the first thing. Do you see yourself as a living temple, as a tabernacle? Is that a beautiful truth, or is that something that never enters our mind? When you look in the mirror, do you see something like this? Is this who you are? Someone who is supposed to have God in them, God living in them? Or do we see ourselves like a football? We see ourselves as our business card, our job title. We see ourselves as the person with this bank account or this car, right? What's our identity? Do we see, no, this is who I am, is made to be a living temple where God, the infinite creator, lives in me, the soul's most welcome guest. And so we celebrate today that made this possible, the Holy Spirit, God, the Father and the Son sending the Holy Spirit upon the church so that the Lord can live in us. And we hear in Romans, we hear the love of God is poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. And so this is one of the gifts that we cherish, the greatest gift we cherish, the greatest gift that God wants to give is his very self, right? He is the gift of God Most High. And so this is the beautiful reality that Pentecost makes possible. And as if that wasn't enough, of course it is enough. It's the infinite gift of God himself. He's generous, right? He gives more, right? And so guide the steps that go astray, we hear in the sequence. That the Lord wants to be not only living in us, he wants to guide us, wants to be our supreme director, the director of our lives. So do we live, this is the second thing of ordering our lives from Pentecost, that we live not under just the direction of our own thoughts. What do I feel like doing today? What do I think will make me happy? We try to live more and more under the direction of the Holy Spirit. Lord, what do you want? Lord, how do you want me to live? And so Archbishop Luis Martinez, who has several works in the Holy Spirit that are very good, one of them is the Sanctifier. He says this, if man had but to accomplish a work of moral perfection according to his human nature, then human reason, a spark from the light of God, would be enough to direct the life of the Spirit. Right, if all it was about being just morally good, right? We can know a lot of morality just by having brains, right? Yes, God has given us the answers in the back of the book, thou shalt not kill. But we should have known that before he said it, right? Before he said it on Mount Sinai. We can just have reason, you know. So this is the starting point. If it was just about being good, we could say, okay, God gave us the light of reason. We know a lot of natural law. And okay, this is what he says. But the work that has to be accomplished in man, as we have already said, is divine. It is the reproduction of Jesus, the masterpiece of God, that we're called to live out the life of Christ, called to conform our lives to Christ. And he continues, and for such an exalted undertaking, the direction of the Holy Spirit is necessary. Sanctity is impossible without this direction. As it is impossible to attain a finished and perfect work of art without the direction of a master. And so, you know, this is where the gifts of the Holy Spirit come in. In your sevenfold gifts descend. The gifts of understanding and knowledge and wisdom and counsel guide us to be able to see things from God's perspective, to understand supernaturally, to be able to discern supernaturally what is the will of God, what will please God. Not just, again, not just on a human level. Well, this is good, and this is what I think will make me happy, therefore this is what God wants. No. You have a supernatural calling. There's more to life than just what I think. God can call a fisherman to drop everything and follow him and become the first pope of the church, right? God can call a computer programmer like myself to say, you know what? Yeah, you're doing all that. You're done with that, right? You're going to go be a priest. What? Okay. He can call us to say, okay, you know what? Yeah, you've got this comfortable life. Everything's good. Now I'm actually going to call you on mission to another country. Okay. Or go talk to that person. Go share the good news with that person, right? He's got a supernatural life for us. Not just a natural, like within our own comfort. He wants a supernatural life. I think of any of the saints, you know, the saints' relics we have here, you know, they lived a supernatural life of contemplation, of mystical prayer that's made possible through the gifts of the Holy Spirit. They loved with a supernatural love, which is made possible through the Holy Spirit's gift of piety. They turned away from sin and persevered in the midst of severe trial, just through the gifts of the fear of the Lord and fortitude. Right? This is the life of the Spirit, that we receive these gifts at baptism. They are strengthened in the sacrament of confirmation, and they're meant to be the very spring of which sanctity flows from. That as the Holy Spirit's gifts grow in us, the sevenfold gifts, we grow in sanctity. We hear, bend the stubborn heart and will, melt the frozen, warm the chill, guide the steps that go astray. Right? We need the Holy Spirit. And then finally, as though there's so much more that could be said, we hear in Jesus' words in the gospel today, as the Father has sent me, so I send you. We hear in the responsorial psalm, Lord, send out your Spirit and renew the face of the earth. We hear that Pentecost, of course, is not only where the Holy Spirit's sent to dwell in us, enliven us, help us be saints, but it's sent, we're sent out through the grace, with the grace of the Holy Spirit, to convert the entire world to Jesus Christ. God wants everyone on earth converted to Jesus Christ, and everyone isn't yet. And so we still have a mission. The majority of the people on the earth are not converted to Jesus Christ yet. And who is responsible for bringing them the good news? Who? Raise your hand if you're responsible for bringing the good news to people. All right. If you didn't raise your hand, confessions are on Monday at 8 a.m. No. All right. So we're responsible, right? You're like, Father, you forgot to raise your hand. Oh, that's true. I did. Yes, we're responsible, right? And we're not responsible on our own efforts alone, right? The Holy Spirit filled the apostles and the disciples to go proclaim, right? They see them speaking in our own tongues of the mighty acts of God. But here in the second reading, to each individual, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for some benefit. And so when we live out the grace of Pentecost, we say, yes, the Holy Spirit's been given to me. His sevenfold gifts are enlivening me, and he's calling me to be a part of the greatest thing ever, bringing souls to Jesus Christ, making an eternal difference. He's not just calling you to go to your job, stamp a part, and go home. As important as ordinary jobs are to provide a living and everything else, he's calling each of us here to change lives that will be changes that last forever. Do you want to affect someone's eternal salvation? Right, this is the invitation to affect people's eternal salvation, to share in the mission of changing souls forever. And we each have a role to play. So do we embrace that role? Send me, Lord. Right, can we pray that prayer? Come, Holy Spirit, send me into your mission field. Come, Holy Spirit, inspire me to share the good news with someone. Come, Holy Spirit, bring people into my life that I can share the good news with. Could we pray like that? Or are we more like, Lord, I don't really want to, whoa. Right, don't stifle. We don't want to stifle the Spirit. So this is the invitation, right? This is what the saints lived out. They knew that the Holy Spirit was dwelling in them, which is their welcomed guest, and they cherished the dwelling of the Lord, that heaven in their soul, they cherished the heavenly King. They knew that they were called to grow in sanctity and live the mission, and so they didn't rely on themselves, they relied on the Holy Spirit. And they said yes to whatever the Lord wanted. Of course, the great one, the greatest of these saints, our own Blessed Mother, we celebrate all throughout the year, but especially during May. So I want to just close with a prayer to her, asking her to intercede. Just as she helped the apostles to open their hearts to the Holy Spirit, she was there at Pentecost. She was there when the church was sent out into the world. She wants to be there with us too. Let's close in a prayer to our Lady. Blessed Mother, please intercede for us that we would cherish the Holy Spirit living in us. We would always stay in a state of grace. If we fall, to get to confession quickly, Blessed Mother, intercede for us that we would grow in the gifts of the Holy Spirit, and intercede for us that we'd have the courage to embrace the mission of the salvation of souls as you did, as you lived out. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death.